Hello everyone, this is Mirzai from Cal Poly Pomona, and in this lesson, we're going to learn how to solve a linear programming problem using the two-phase method. Two-phase method is an alternative for the big M method. So we use the two-phase method for the LPs that have greater than or equal or equal signs in their constraints. In the big M method, we learn how we use x's and artificial variables to standardize the constraints with greater than or equal signs. If you are not familiar with the concept of excess and artificial variables, please stop this lesson, go back to the big M method lesson, learn the concept of excess and artificial variable, and then come back to this video. To understand the two-phase method, let's look at one example. Suppose we have a maximization problem as shown on this screen. If you recall, this is the exact problem that we earlier solved using the big M method. Before solving any optimization problem, using a simplex method, the first step is to standardize the problem. For constraints with less than or equal sign, we learn the concept of slack variables in the simplex method. Also, for constraints with greater than or equal sign, we learn the concept of excess and artificial variables in the big M method lesson. In the big M method, also we understood to deal with artificial variables and to encourage the simplex method to get rid of the artificial variables along the way, we need to add the artificial variables with a negative M coefficient to the objective of a maximization problem and positive M to the objective function of minimization problem. This way, we encourage the simplex method to reduce the value of A4 along the way and hopefully to eliminate A4 by kicking this variable out of the basis and making it equal to 0. The concept of two-phase method is pretty similar, with the difference that this time we do this operation in two phases. In the first phase, our objective is to minimize the summation of all the artificial variables that exist in the problem. At the end of the first phase, if we reach to a point that there is no artificial variable in the basis, we have a feasible solution to this problem. Otherwise, we have no feasible solution to this problem. So in the first phase, our objective function is to minimize the summation of all the artificial variables. In this example, we just have one artificial variable, so our objective function is to minimize A4. Now, we need to standardize this objective function. In addition, we know that all the decision variables have a positive value in a linear programming problem. Now, we are good to start the simplex table. And we can start entering the coefficient of the decision variables in the simplex table. In the row of z, we have to replace the coefficient of objective function for the new objective function that we have defined. According to the definition, in the column related to the basic variables, you have to see the coefficient of 1 only in the row related to that basic variable, and all the other values in the column related to a basic variable must be 0. To see the same pattern for S2, which is a basic variable, S3, that is a basic variable, and you have to see the same pattern for A4, which is a basic variable. However, for A4, in the row of Z, we see the value of -1, which is not following the usual definition of a basic variable. In this column, we have to see 1 in the row related to A4, which we see that value, and everything else should be 0. This value must change to 0. To change the -1 to 0, we have to use elementary row operation. The row that I can use for this elementary row operation is row 4. All the other values in this column related to A4 is 0, and if I multiply anything by these three rows, it gives me the value of 0, and then when I add it with the row of z, it doesn't change anything. So the only option that I have is A4. If I multiply this row by 1 and then add it with the row of z, I'm able to generate the value of 0 under A4 in the row of Z that I'm looking for. So let's do this elementary row operation, which is R4 plus the row of Z, and this is the new row of Z that we have. Now in this new table, the conditions for all the basic decision variables are met, and we are good to continue the simplex table. No matter if your original objective function is a maximization or a minimization, your first phase always starts with a minimization problem. In a minimization problem, the optimality condition is when all the variables here are negative or 0. Since there are two positive values here, we can continue this table to an optimality condition. So in a minimization, we'll look for the most positive value in the row of z. In this example, x2 is the most positive value in the row of z, so it is our pivot column. To define what is the exiting decision variable, we have to implement the minimum test. As you know, we only implement the minimum test on the positive value of the pivot column, which in this case, all values are positive in this column. So if I do the minimum test by dividing the right-hand side by these values, the minimum value is 75, which is related to the row 4. The intersection of the pivot column and pivot row shows the pivot value, which is 2. In the next table, our job is to replace A4 by X2. So this is the new table where X2 has replaced A4. Now, to change 2 to 1, we simply need to divide the fourth row of the old table by 2. If I do this operation, this is the new row that I get. Now, using this pivot row here, or the pivot row in the old table, I have to manipulate all the other rows in a way that gives me value of 0 in these three rows as well as in the row of z. So let's define elementary row operation for this purpose. To change the first row, if I multiply the pivot row by -1 and then adding it with this row here, I'm able to generate that 0 here. Let's do this elementary row operation, which is negative pivot row in the new table plus the first row in the old table. If I implement this operation, this is the new table that I get. Now, to change the value of 1 here to 0, again, I have to multiply the pivot row in the new table by -1 and adding it with the second row to generate 0 here. Let's do this elementary row operation. Negative R4 in the new table plus the second row in the old table. And this is the new values that we get for the second row. For the third row, I can multiply this pivot row by -2 and adding it with this row to generate 0 here. Alternatively, you can multiply the pivot row in the new table by -4 and adding it with this row to generate 0 here. So it's up to you which one you want to use. As far as you're using the pivot row, it doesn't matter which one you're using, the pivot row in the new table or in the old table, because they are linear combination of one another. So in this case, what I used is the pivot row in the old table to generate the value of 0 for this element here. Now for the row of z, if I just multiply this row by -1 and adding it with the row of z here, I'm able to generate that 0. So the elementary row operation that I selected here is multiplying the fourth row in the old table and adding it with the row of z, just because it's easier calculation. We don't need to multiply this row by -2. We just simply multiply this row by -1. So it's just a simpler operation. That's why I decided to do that. So if I implement this operation, this is the new row of z that I get here. So let's check for the optimality condition. Remember, in the first phase, we always solve a minimization problem. And for a minimization problem, we reach to an optimal table where all the coefficients in the row of z are 0 or negative. So as you see, all the values are negative or 0 here, so we have reached the optimality condition in this case. So the table is optimal. Now, what is the meaning of this table? In this table, as you see, there is no artificial variable in the basis. You see here, there is no artificial variable. This means that A4, which is an artificial variable, is a non-basic variable, therefore has a value of 0. And your objective function value, that was z equal to A4, is equal to 0, because A4 simply has the value of 0. So the value of objective function is 0, which implies the value of artificial variable is 0. Thus, the problem has a feasible solution. In this condition, since we got rid of A4 from our basis, we are good to go to the next phase and solve the problem with the original objective function. If we had reached the optimality condition and we still had a basic artificial variable here, then our problem in general didn't have a feasible solution. But since we got rid of the artificial variable and its value has reduced to 0, we are good to go to the next phase and solve the problem with the original objective function. To be able to do that, since we have gotten rid of the artificial variable here, We also need to get rid of the column related to a form, and we can standardize the original objective function and replace it in the row of z. Now, in the row of z, again, we have a condition where a basic variable has a value in the row of z. So we have to get rid of this negative 4 and reduce it to 0. Again, we have to define an elementary row operation using the fourth row of this table and change that negative 4 to a value of 0. If I multiply the fourth row of this table by 4 and adding it with the row of z, then I'm able to generate that 0 that I was looking for. This time, remember, we're solving a maximization problem. Because we are in the second phase, we are solving for the actual objective function of the problem, which is a maximization problem. So for a maximization problem, the optimality condition is when you have everything positive or zero in the row of z. Whereas here, we don't see everything positive or zero. We see two negative values, so we can continue this table by looking at the most negative value, which is related to E4. If I implement the minimum test, we see that the minimum value is related to the second row. Again, I implemented a minimum test only on the positive value of the pivot row. The pivot row from the minimum test will be the second row here, and 1/2 is the pivot value. In the next table, E4 will replace S2. Also, I have to make sure that the column related to E4 follows the condition related to a basic variable, which is the value of 1 for the row related to E4 and 0 for all the other elements of the E4 column. So this is a new table where E4 has replaced S2, and elementary row operation for changing 1/2 to 1 is multiplying this row by 2. If I implement this elementary row operation, this is the new second row that I get. Now I have to use pivot row in the new table or pivot row in the old table to manipulate the other elements of the pivot column. For changing the first element to 0, it's easier to use the pivot row in the old table because if I multiply this row by negative 1 and adding it with this row, I'm able to get the value of 0 for the first element of pivot column. So let's do this operation, which is negative R2 in the old table plus R1 in the old table, and this is the new row that we get. For the third row, it's easier to use this row because if I multiply it by negative 2 and then adding it with this row, I'm able to get the value of 0 for the third element of the pivot column. So negative 2 multiplied by the new pivot row plus the third row in the old table. If I implement this operation, this is the new row that I get. To change the fourth element of the pivot column to 0, it's easier to use the pivot row in the old table because if I just simply add these two rows, I'm able to generate 0 here. So the elementary row operation will be the pivot row in the old table plus the fourth row in the old table. That gives me this new row. As you see, every time we're trying to find what should be multiplied by the pivot row in the old table or the new table, where when we add the resulting vector to the row that we want to see the change in it, we are able to see that change. So every time, think about what should be multiplied by the pivot row, where you added with the existing row, you can see that change in that row. For the row of z, I have to think what should be multiplied by this row, where when I add it with this row, I'm able to see 0 here. As you see, if I multiply this second row by 2 and then adding it with the row of z, I'm able to see that 0. So 2 multiplied the pivot row in the new table plus the row of z gives me the value of 0. Now remember, we are in a maximization problem, and for a maximization problem, we are at the optimal table where everything is positive or 0. So these are all positive or 0, so we have reached the optimality condition. The value of decision variables according to the simplex table are given, and all the other decision variables that we don't see in the basis have the value of 0. The value of objective function is 900. This is exactly the same result that we got from the Big M method. So if you compare the result with the Big M method, you will see that they are the same. So in the two-phase method, instead of adding the artificial variable with a big M coefficient to the objective function with positive or negative signs, we divided the problem in two phases. First, we try to minimize the value of artificial variable. So we define a new objective function, which is the summation of all artificial variables. And in the first place, we always try to minimize the objective function, no matter if your original objective function is a maximization or a minimization. At the end of the first phase, if you reach to an optimal solution that doesn't include an artificial variable in the basis, then we have a feasible solution to our problem. Now we have to get rid of the column related to the artificial variable and standardize the objective function of the original problem, and then try to continue solving the problem in the next phase. However, if you end up at an optimal solution that includes artificial variable in the basis at the end of the first phase, you just report that your problem doesn't have a feasible solution because you couldn't get rid of the artificial variable in the first place. Here, we review the three most common conditions that can happen at the end of the first phase in a two-phase method. In the first condition, there is no artificial variable in the basis. So that's a sign that there is a feasible solution for this problem. So we need to eliminate the column related to the artificial variable and move on to the next phase. The second condition is where we have reached the optimality condition at the end of the first phase, but there is an artificial variable with a positive value in the basis of the simplex table. That's a sign that there is no feasible solution for this problem. The third condition happens when we have reached the optimality condition at the end of the first phase of the two-phase method, and there is a basic artificial variable which has a value of zero. In this case, we can eliminate the row and column related to the artificial variable and move on to the next phase. With this, our lesson in two-phase method has concluded. Please refer to your blackboard for your assignments.